I'm really excited to be here. I think when initially the Aragon team approached me, there was some talk on Reddit that I shouldn't be allowed to speak, which I thought was really funny. We're talking about decentralized censorship-resistant systems, and I think whenever we're encountered with ideas that we don't like, we have this urge to sort of repress those ideas. But today I want to talk to you, I want to use data, which is what I like to do, to just talk about how governance mechanisms and power actually works in a lot of the crypto economic systems that have been designed. And the last year has been a really exciting year. I started working in the crypto space about 5 years ago. And at that time, it was really just Bitcoin. And we always talked about this idea of staking and on-chain governance, and it sounded really exciting and futuristic. And it's now a reality. Now we have a number of protocols that are in existence where holders of tokens can actually participate in formal on-chain governance. And just seeing how these systems have been implemented, seeing what the result has been, arguably over their short lifespan, has been very insightful for me personally. And today I just want to share some of my observations. I want to link it back to some of the broader themes we're seeing around both on-chain and off-chain governance and talk about where I think the ecosystem might be headed. So, disclosure, I invest in cryptocurrencies companies in the space, so you can see all of my disclosures online. I'm going to talk about five protocols today, and I am an investor in two of them, Tezos and Decred, full disclosure, so you know my incentives. So here's what we're going to talk about. Number one, on-chain governance. What is it? How is it working today? I want to talk a little bit about who has the right to govern. I think this is a question we explore a lot, and I think in particular this last discussion you just heard about Venezuela, that's the place where we're actually seeing this play out in real time. The third thing I want to talk about is who actually has the will to govern. So we'll talk a little bit about participation rates and what that tells us about who actually has an incentive in this case to do all of the work required to learn how to stake and participate in governance. I want to make a brief case for crypto cartels. When I say cartels, I don't mean them in the negative economic sense that we want to repress competitiveness. What I mean is I think there is a strong case here for collusion between actors who are financially incentivized to vote for certain outcomes, and they may actually be net positive outcomes. There's not always a net negative externality, but let's talk about it. And then I want to talk briefly about the history of political organizations, particularly a man named Polybius and what he came up with 3,000 years ago, which I think is still relevant today and might actually teach us something. All right, no one's asleep yet. So with that said, let's dive right into it. So I think governance is first and foremost a massive experiment, right? We're seeing this play out in the political world we live in today, in the US in particular, where I live. You know, governance right now is not working so well because our federal government is shut down. It's not operating. So that to me is, you know, interesting to be having this conversation at a time when many political systems in our world are not performing the way we would expect them to. But when I think about blockchain governance, really what I think about is you have these various layers of the blockchain stack. So we have the protocols. On top of that, we have networks where these protocols get expressed in physical compute space. And there you have miners, people running nodes. In some cases, you have people running block producers, baking services, whatever they may be called, and the particular consensus mechanism of that protocol. And then what's been interesting to see is the emergence of both on-chain governance tools and off-chain governance tools. And then on top of that, we have the application layer where people are building applications, products, services that token holders, users would interact with. So at the on-chain layer, what I think has been interesting to see is the rise of delegation services, voting service providers, staking pools, and other services that really intend to aggregate and provide proxy voting tools to participants in a network. And then the off-chain layer, I think particularly with the ICO boom over the last 2 years, we've seen the creation of these foundations. I think the Ethereum Foundation was one of the first to pioneer it. But we see more and more entities evolving to using voting tools, polling tools, providing community updates, having forums, having foundations that really play this role of creating formal and informal governance mechanisms to enable people to talk at a social level first and then make decisions that may or may not be encoded into the protocol. So current on-chain governance projects. So again, we're going to go through quite a bit of data. Hopefully it's not too boring. And I will post all of the slides online after this, so no need to take photos, et cetera, unless you really want to. I share everything online. So let's go through them really quickly. So we have these five different protocols I want to talk about that are probably the best established proof of stake kind of on-chain governance projects. So EOS has been around less than a year. What I think is really interesting about this column, what I outlined is, what's the mechanism for consensus? How long has the network been running? I call this age. What does participation in the network look like? How many parties are involved in participating in the network? And what is the risk model for people who decide to participate in governance? Because that's very important. In cases where you actually have to expose your assets to risk by putting them on chain, by giving them to a counterparty, by giving up control of the assets themselves, there's actually a very strong disincentive for people to participate in governance unless they have certain guarantees about that level of risk and the implied reward of participating in governance. So just looking at some of the statistics here, in EOS, only 25% of EOS holders are actually actively involved in voting for the block producers. So that to me is a fairly low number. If we look at the Dash model, 55% of all Dash in circulation is allocated to these things called master nodes, and there are roughly 5,000 quote-unquote master nodes. If we look at NEO, NEO's one where it's really difficult to get information about how governance in NEO works, but the foundation underlying NEO holds 50% of all of the tokens, and they run the majority of the nodes in the NEO network. Tezos, which is where I run a baking service, so I have my own delegation service that I run. It's been a very interesting experiment. There are around 500 bakers that provide services to people who hold tokens, and roughly 80% of the tokens have been delegated, meaning they'll participate in on-chain governance. And there are very different risk models. You can delegate at no risk, but if you want to bake and actually have a vote, you have to take a material amount of risk. And then lastly, Decred is kind of a unique one that uses a hybrid mechanism. We actually use your Decred to buy tickets. These tickets can then be utilized to vote. You do have to pay a transaction fee. Your Decred is locked when you purchase a ticket. And there are these things called voting service providers that will help you vote. They typically charge a fee. And roughly 50% of the Decred in circulation is actively being used to buy tickets and vote on propositions. But what I think is really interesting, so we went from these things being experiments, and now, today, these five networks actually represent roughly $4 billion of market value. So to me, that's a really interesting sign that people are interested in implementing on-chain governance. They are interested in experimenting with these new tools. And people are willing to put a significant amount of financial capital onto these very experimental, very new networks. So in a way, this is very heartening for the future of on-chain governance. So then I want to talk a little bit. I have some more numbers. Why risk and reward matter? So if we look here, I've written a little bit about the governance model for each protocol, what it means to set up a service that participates in governance, what the risk model is, and what the ROI is for participating in governance. So in EOS, you get nothing, supposedly, for voting for block producers, but now actually there are block producers who are paying people to vote for them. So think about that. That's a little weird. It's quite expensive to run a block producer. And the ROI is quite high if you run one, but if you vote, there's no ROI. In Dash, master nodes get to vote on governance. You need a lot of Dash, about $67,000 worth to run a node, but there's really no risk, and you get an ROI of 7 to 10% per year. In NEO, there are these consensus nodes, and there's a time lock on your NEO when you elect nodes, but you don't really get a return. You just get to choose who makes changes to the protocol. Tezos is the one I know best. Bakers are going to vote in these things called amendment processes. There hasn't been an amendment yet, but there will be one in February, which I'm excited about, so I'll actually get to test this mechanism. And people pay a fee to delegate. If you're a baker, you have to have at least $4,000 worth of Tezos, or what's called a roll to bake. And if you bake, you take risk because you stake 10% of your tokens on-chain, so there's a risk of theft, but the ROI is pretty high, 5 to 15%, which is pretty good. And then lastly, we talked about Decred's ticket mechanism a bit, and tickets are really expensive. tickets at today's prices are roughly $2,000 a ticket. But if you only own a couple of Decred, you can't really participate in voting. There are people trying to design services and tools that will allow that, but doesn't really exist yet. But really what I want to illuminate here is participating in governance is really confusing. This is just five protocols we've talked about. There are dozens of protocols coming out that are trying to implement on-chain governance, and your average user has a really, really hard time figuring out how to do this for just one protocol. I know for myself, I spent about 80 hours trying to figure out how to set up a Tezos delegation service, how to run a Baker, et cetera. And so there's a real human cost, a real trade-off in terms of the time and energy people have to invest to participate in these systems, which is really relevant here. All right, so why does this matter? Why this matters is because of power. Politics is about power. What we just heard about Venezuela, a lot of these decisions that get made by people who want to either A, exert power, B, preserve their power, or C, take power from others. Or, in a positive case, extend power to others. So there are really four parties, in my view, that constitute the power players in any particular protocol. There's the exchanges, right? Exchange users, they centralize all of these tokens on exchange, and typically they really have no control over their keys or their assets. They're using a central intermediary to custody these assets. So they have limited ability to stake or delegate their tokens, although some protocols have and some exchanges are offering these services. And some exchanges, actually, I've heard, are delegating tokens for profit without the approval of the token holders or without sharing those proceeds with token holders. So it's kind of like a bank taking your money, lending it out, and not paying you any of the risk capital in return. Interesting. Let's talk about investors. So we have all of these crypto funds and VCs and investors who buy really material amounts of these tokens, and they have vested interest in a specific outcome. An investor is a fiduciary. Their responsibility is not to deploy a network or to run a cool social experiment. It's to make money for their investors. And I think we sometimes forget this dichotomy in crypto land. They're heavily pursued by service providers who charge 5, 10% to set up these staking services for them and help them in governance. And then some of these funds also actively collude to run their own pools and their own staking services. A great example is in the case of EOS. There was a lot of discussion in the EOS community about collusion between large Chinese investors and the exchange Huobi to run EOS block producers and ensure that a certain number of votes went to specific block producers to ensure they kept receiving the block reward. Interesting. Then we have foundations. So in many cases, the foundations underlying these protocols are granted or given a certain number of tokens or a certain percentage of tokens in order to help steward the development of these protocols. Now, typically, these foundations shouldn't have the right to vote in governance outcomes, right? It seems a little bit of a conflict of interest if a foundation has 30, 50% of tokens that they're participating in voting because they automatically would have a supermajority. Well, in some cases, foundations may be incentivized to vote or to proxy their voting to others in order to grant themselves more capital. However, I think a lot of foundations are also actively looking into research and tools to enable voting and participation in governance to become easier. And then lastly, the project teams themselves. Again, these people own a lot of tokens. There's limited clarity as to how many tokens these teams are receiving, whether they're using them to stake or participate in governance, and there's really no disclosure around conflicts, which I think is really troubling, particularly when we talk about politics. All right, so let's talk about the incentives. And again, we're going to go back to this data outlook. So if we look at all these different protocols and the way that exchanges, investors, foundations, and teams interact with them, it starts to become very, very clear that in each of these cases, there are certain groups that have a lot of power in the governance of these protocols, and as a result, are incentivized to collaborate in specific ways to maintain their power over these protocols. And it's very, very difficult to find this information. You have to do a lot of digging. I myself spent about 4 hours last night trying to fill in holes in this table. And if anyone has better sources than I do, would welcome that. But there are all of these funny games going on when it comes to these players and how they participate in the governance of these systems. And it's very important to me for us to understand and to have transparency transparency around how the systems we participate in and the systems we support with our capital, not just our financial capital, but our human capital, our talent, and our social capital, and our time and energy, it's very important that we understand how they're governed, how they're run, and what the power structure is. To me, that's one of the most important things we're examining here. And to be frank, as a community, I don't think we're doing a great job, myself included, which is why I wanted to come and talk about it here. And turnout really depends on stakes. What I was thinking about is, okay, well, how many people typically vote? Right, and turnout is often going to depend on the stakes. So some recent political events here in blue, recent German election, had nearly 80% turnout. Right, it's a really critical election, a lot going on in the Eurozone. Brexit, 75% turnout. Again, really critical event. These are representative voting systems, but they work. US 2016 election, nearly 60% turnout. But then we look at what's happening in these on-chain governance proposals. Again, depending on how large the size of the pot is or how important the decision is, turnout can really differ. From a Dash masternode perspective, we see about 55% participation. When Decred rolled out their Politea system to decentralize their treasury and allow people to vote on how money was spent using their Decred tickets, we saw about a 50% turnout. EOS, surprisingly, despite how much capital is at stake, has a fairly low voter turnout, which is shocking to me. One of my assumptions here is that many EOS holders use exchanges to hold their EOS and aren't actively managing their EOS themselves, which may explain why turnout is so low. We look at the Ethereum hard fork in 2016. Only 5% of Ether holders participated in that vote. 5%, and that was a pretty important decision to roll back the chain. And more importantly, that 5% of Ethereum tokens that participated mostly belonged to large holders. It represented a very small sample size of the population. So very interesting. And then Aragon, why we're here. One of the issues that's been discussed in the Aragon community is how to make voting easier and encourage higher turnout, particularly in the AGP one vote that happened. I think turnout was around 3%, John? I'm looking at you. You know the facts here. But again, I think, you know, it's great that we have these tools. It's great that we have the capability to use these systems. But if people find these tools really difficult to use, if they're very complex to use, if they require capital, if they require technical expertise, how are we going to get people to participate in these systems? These are very real design problems that aren't about how brilliant the tech is or how complex the systems can be. It's about how we very simply get people to go and fucking vote. Like, this is a problem we've tried to solve in America, and it's really hard. But how do we get people to go and vote? This is a really important question. So governance, in my view, is really a skill. And this is where my call for collusion and cartels comes in. And I promise you, it's not negative. It's intended to be positive. But if you think about participating in governance, it really requires three skills. It requires technical skill, it requires financial skill, and it requires political skill. Today, you need stable hardware. You need the ability to custody assets that may be at risk. You need to have high uptime or availability, and Decred in particular. Your wallet must be online at all times. You can't miss blocks. Etc. Tomorrow, as these systems grow and expand, and as the amount of capital involved in these systems grows and expands, it's going to become much more important to have simple interfaces, tools to help people manage taxes, particularly if they receive income. You need stable, secure infrastructure and facilities that are resilient to attack, whether those are cyber attacks or physical attacks, especially if these systems are going to have material value on them. In terms of financial competence, today there are a lot of mechanics around calculating ROI, particularly in an environment where token prices are falling 80, 90%. If you lock up a bunch of tokens to stake, there's zero ROI. Even if the return is 100% in token terms, you're still losing capital because you own more of something that has lost a bunch of value. So how do you think about ROI? How do you think about participation? In the future, there are a lot of needs for automated accounting tools, automated payout tools, thinking about compounding interest, transparency around how fee structures work and who gets what part of a fee, and also more engineering around stakeholder incentives. I think it's interesting to hear that we now have EOS block producers sharing their block reward with people who vote for them. right? In a way, this is what happens in where I'm from in Turkey. The government pays people to vote for them. It's a crazy dynamic, but you can see why there's an incentive. And then lastly, I think what we tend to ignore in crypto, because we like to believe it's a meritocracy, is we are all politicians at the end of the day. Humans since the dawn of time have been political animals, and we see this expressed in the crypto world through thought leadership. People blog, people tweet, people go to conferences like these and speak. Myself, I'm here on a stage. But if you look at the future, I think we're going to see a lot more proxy voting. We're going to see people with political competence start to enter this ecosystem. And when the stakes get high enough, you're going to start people come in and campaign, manage optics, engage in mass-scale marketing. And you have to have really deep knowledge of these projects and governance mechanisms to do that effectively. So where does this lead all of us? If we put it all together, right, if we think about competitive markets, there's really this spectrum that markets exist on. And on one end, you have perfect competition. And on the other end, you have a completely non-competitive market where it's just a monopoly, no competition at all. Today, most businesses, particularly online businesses, operate closer to the monopoly part of the scale. But if we think about what we're trying to do with crypto, what we really want is we want to have competition, but we also need social coordination. So I actually think we kind of exist in this state that's somewhere between pure competition and pure monopoly, where we can have explicit or implicit agreements to collude to maximize profits or maximize outcomes, depending on your incentives, which can take the form of joint ventures, mergers, partnerships, and cartels. And we see this all the time. Think about all the partnership announcements that come out. It's typically people collaborating to provide some sort of new service to make these projects more valuable, to make them more functional. So again, when I say oligopoly, when I say cartel, these are not necessarily negative social structures. They can have positive impacts, but it's important to recognize that these are implicit and explicit agreements to collude and collaborate towards specific outcomes, and communicating how that happens is very important. And the incentives are huge, right? In EOS, if you get to run a block producer at today's prices, you get $5 million a year. Who here would like $5 million a year? No one? No one? Okay, thank you for being honest. All right, that's a lot of money. There's a big incentive here. If the price of that token goes up 2x, all of a sudden that's 10 million. If we look at NEO, it's $1 million. If we look at Tezos, it's 500,000 or more. There are massive financial incentives for people, and it's naive to ignore the dynamics that are at play here. And so what we're seeing is emergent collusion between these players. And really, I think this is not a bad thing. The type of work that's being done on these different networks should influence who's doing the work. Not all networks are built the same. No one has the expertise to participate in governance on all of these networks. Funds don't have the capacity to do this themselves, and individual investors and holders certainly don't. So I am all for the creation of tools like Aragon and others that enable people to participate in governance simply by proxying out their vote, by understanding what type of entity they're giving their tokens to make it easier, because if it's really, really hard and really complex and technical and requires a lot of capital, no one's going to do it. And speculators are not users. You have to remember that not everyone's incentive is to participate in governance. There are a lot of people in the crypto community who participate in these networks who have a motive of profit. And so lastly, I'll end with this sequence, which I think is like a fun little history lesson. So Polybius was this philosopher 3,000 years ago, and he basically looked at all these different forms of governance and realized that all forms of human political organization go in this sort of cycle. You start with a monarchy, a leader emerges, he's wise, he has a lot of talent, he's very influential, and that leader passes power to his offspring through heredity. It's a monarchy. Then it goes to tyranny, right? Everyone's like, oh, this authoritarian. And so the aristocrats, the influential, powerful people emerge and they take power and overthrow the monarchy. Then they pass that off to their offspring, everyone gets tired of it, and democracy emerges. Rule by many. But democracy is a weak and fragile structure, as we see. And then what we see is everyone gets entitled and the mob emerges and people begin to shout and everyone gets angry and the democracy caters to the rule of the mob and it becomes an oligarchy. And then eventually in that chaos and anarchy, you see another leader emerge. And you could basically map this to several crypto protocols if you wanted to, where you see one strong leader, that strong leader sort of gets overthrown, a mob rises up, becomes angry, new leader emerges. So look, I'm not trying to poke fun at anything here, but I do think there's a lot to learn from historical forms of governance. So lessons: rulers must have short tenure, keep them from becoming despots. External threats: fighting against someone else preserves peace, so find a common enemy. It's a great way to build community. If any one individual has too much power, monetary, political, military, banish them. So think about that in the context of crypto assets. Decision makers and governance bodies should never accept money, right? They should be funded in a non sort of conflicting way to keep them neutral. The middle class, or a group of mid-sized decision makers, should be very large. We don't have that in protocols today. There's like people who hold a lot of tokens and people with very small amounts. And then most importantly, education. People need to understand law, history, constitution, governance, so that they know how to maintain good governance. So that's all I had to say. Hopefully you found that interesting. Email me, tweet me, come find me. Thanks for your time.